Hello, this is Strike Fighters 2 Vietnam. Welcome, new friends, and welcome back, old friends. In this episode, we'll continue flying A6 intruders off the USS Enterprise, following Lieutenant Commander Devin Horner, as he supports Rolling Thunder over Vietnam. Today's date is January 15th, 1967. Our objective is going to be to strike a strategic target located in the Nam Dinh warehouse storage area. We have to destroy the warehouse in the area. Call sign is Cowboy. Aircraft will be two A6 intruders. Takeoff time of 12:06 in the afternoon. Here's our loadout for aircraft 300. We have 20 Mark 82 Snake Eyes, and Cowboy 2 has the same 20 Mark 82 Snake Eyes and a 300-gallon drop tank. Looking at the map, our flight altitude today will be 5,900 feet, heading over the city of Nam Dinh to blow up that target. We can see that fighters in the area, we're going to have those same J-5s and MiG-17s and MiG-21s that we saw last time, one of which shot down our wingman, Lieutenant Hyduck. Here we've got ground forces scattered around. Let's take a look at our friendly flights in the area besides ourselves. Tiger is four Crusaders going to some other industrial complex. Here's eight A4s heading back to Kien An airfield. We've seen A4 strikes on Kien An several times, which is this guy right here. An AN-2 squadron is stationed there. There we go. Here's our escort, Denver, four F4 Phantoms, where that will be escorting us into Nam Dinh. And that wraps it up for Navy flights. Here's the roster. We're up to 45 missions now. And Cowboy 2 is going to be Lieutenant Jack Taylor with 11 combat missions and 13 ground kills. All right, short and sweet on the briefing today. Heading back into Vietnam for a day bombing mission. We'll see you up there as we climb into our A6 and get prepared to launch off the Enterprise. All right, welcome up to the flight deck. As we get ready to go, we can see that big, wide jet blast deflector is engaged, ready to go. Controls are good. Salute the shooting officer. Shooter gives the sign, thumbs up, away we go. Gear and flaps up. We bank 20 degrees off to the right of ship's heading, and we're going to climb up to 500 feet and level off. Now I'm going to go 20 degrees back to go parallel with the ship's course as we proceed 7 miles out away from the ship before we begin our climb. This is our standard case 1 departure from the carrier. There are 3 different cases. They're based on meteorological conditions. Case 1 is daytime, visibility greater than 5 nautical miles, with a ceiling of greater than 3,000 feet. Since we have light fluffy clouds way up high today with beautiful visibility, then we're clearly case 1 VFR. Case 2 is day with visibility greater than 5 miles, ceiling less than 3,000 feet, but greater than 1,000 feet. So a low ceiling day with decent visibility, case 2. Case 3 is nighttime or fog, or daytime with visibility less than 5 miles, ceiling less than 1,000 feet. So a really rainy, fogged in day is case 3. That's full IFR. Case 1 has been what we've normally been using, and that is full VFR. All 3 cases have specific departure and arrival procedures for the carrier, and I'm going to start trying to use those more in each episode to sprinkle a little bit of realism in as we come and go from the carrier. As for the rest of a normal case 1 departure, at 7 miles we would turn to then intercept the 10 mile circular holding pattern around the ship. I believe that's where the flights marshal up, get in formation, And then as you go around the circle, you reach your departure vector heading, and then you would depart from the holding pattern and then start to climb up to altitude with the whole flight intact. Obviously, this game doesn't support that in any way, so we're not going to go that in-depth. But in real life, that's what they do. So what I'm going to do is go out to about 7 miles and then just turn to my departure vector and then start to climb then, and then the AI will come in and get on my wings. Today I want to talk about a thing that is integral to naval aviation. Launching aircraft within just a few hundred feet of a flight deck is impressive, but wouldn't be of much use if there wasn't a way to get planes back on board in the same amount of space. Arresting gear is the flip side of catapult systems, and is the most important element of naval aviation. There are several methods of launching aircraft off of carriers that don't involve catapults at all, but even World War II carriers, or modern ones with short takeoff ramps, still use arresting gear. Arresting gear is a system of steel cables across a landing area. A hook from a landing plane catches one of the wires, and the kinetic energy of the plane is transferred by the cable to a hydraulic or water engine that stops the plane. Arresting gear was invented by American Hugh Robinson in 1910 when he became chief engineer for Glenn Curtiss, the father of naval aviation. Curtiss Aviation arranged the first demonstration of an aircraft launch from a ship in late 1910. 2 months later, in January of 1911, pilot Eugene Ely landed his Curtiss pusher aboard the USS Pennsylvania using Hugh Robinson's arresting cable system. These early systems used weights attached to the cables to slow the aircraft. The modern hydraulic version of the arresting cable was designed by Commander Colin Mitchell in 1931, the same Scotsman we talked about designing the modern steam catapult system. The Mark 7 Mod 3 is the arresting type used by the U.S. Navy, and can stop a landing plane in 340 feet within 2 seconds. A series of 4 arresting cables are laid out on the deck in the landing area. They lay across metal leaf springs in the deck that elevate them just a few inches up. The wires are numbered 1 through 4 as they move forward up the deck. Aiming for and hitting wire number 3 is considered the perfect landing. Each cable is attached through giant pulleys to a piston in an oil-filled cylinder. When the arresting hook engages the cable, the piston is pulled through the cylinder as oil is vented out through the constant run-out control valve. This brings the aircraft to a controlled stop in a fast but smooth manner. Cold War-era carriers used the 4-cable system, including Enterprise, but the last 2 Nimitz ships, the Ronald Reagan and the George Bush, were built with only 3 wires. In this system, middle wire number 2 is now the optimal catch. The 3-wire system is now becoming standard, as it was also built into the Gerald Ford. Each aircraft type has a maximum trap weight, and this is entered by arresting gear operators before each landing. This ensures that the system will stop the aircraft before it runs over the edge of the flight deck. Aircraft arriving over the carrier can routinely be seen dumping fuel on the downwind leg to drop the aircraft weight to its standard max trap weight. Retracting the cable after a trap is done with a motor, either electric or combustion engine. After the aircraft lands, plane handlers on the deck give a hand signal to the arresting gear operators to tug the plane slightly backwards. As the jet rolls backwards, the hook disengages from the cable. The hook is then raised, and the plane taxis out of the landing area as the cable is fully retracted. The center section of each arresting cable is actually a removable segment, connected by metal turnbuckles to the longer cables leading down to the arresting engines. These cables are constantly inspected during flight ops for signs of failure. After 125 captures, the sections are swapped out. Swapping a cable is done in about 3 minutes. Despite this scrutiny, sometimes cables will fail, and the results can be devastating. A snapped cable can mean that a captured aircraft will fail to stop. Even at full power, if there's not enough deck space left to gain speed, the plane can roll overboard and into the sea. Additionally, the cable experiences what is called snapback. Mooring lines can experience this too, and we received extensive training on this in boot camp, including videos showing the effects of snapback. When a cable or line snaps under high tension, the energy pent up inside the material is now released. An elastic reaction occurs down the material, and the two ends of the broken cable fly out of control. These loose ends have enough energy to do serious damage to a person, sometimes very messily. A YouTube video shows the effects of a cable break aboard the USS George Washington in 2003. In the video, an F-18 traps, then the cable snaps. The pilot ejects as the Hornet goes overboard with not enough airspeed to recover. The loose cable, moving at 100 miles an hour, damages equipment on the deck and breaks the legs of several sailors as they get tripped by it. 7 flight deck crew were injured, with 3 seriously injured being helicoptered back to Norfolk. In March of 2016, a cable snapped on board the Dwight D. Eisenhower, the first in 11 years since the 2003 incident. This time, an E-2 Hawkeye, a VAW-123, incidentally the Hawkeye squadron that had been on Enterprise with me, snapped number 4 cable on landing. The plane disappears over the side for what seems like an eternity, but the pilots pulled it out only 20 feet over the waves. The Hawkeye ponderously climbs back into view and pulls away from the ship. The pilots received medals, and no one on board the plane was hurt. But on deck, it was a different story. The cables did $200,000 worth of damage and injured 8 sailors. 6 were airlifted to Norfolk with serious injuries, including broken legs, ankles, a fractured skull with traumatic brain injury, and more. In an emergency where an aircraft cannot use its arresting hook, or where landing gear is damaged, carriers can employ the emergency barricade. The barricade is a 20-foot-tall net that is rigged across the flight deck and attached to one of the arresting cables. The barricade catches the aircraft as it lands, wrapping its wings and bringing it to a halt. This can be seen in several YouTube videos, and was demonstrated with an F-8 Crusader in the movie The Final Countdown. ECM is going on as we're approaching the coast of Vietnam here. We are 7 miles away from our initial point, in which case we'll turn right and then head in over that bay towards Nam Dinh. We're at 20,000 feet, doing about 360 knots for Mach 0.82. We've seen that there's a lot of aircraft in the air today over Vietnam. Lots of friendlies and lots of enemies, including MiG-21s and MiG-17s. So we're going to keep an eye out for them. Because we don't need a repeat of last mission. And there we go. We're hitting our initial point. So now we're going to turn up. We're going to follow this bay right up to Nam Dinh. And on the far side is going to be the warehouse. Now this bay is actually the Delta of the Red River, which of course is the same river that flows through Hanoi. It flows down here to Nam Dinh, turns into this this wide delta, and then flows out to the ocean. We can see those ground targets there just off to our 11 o'clock on the radar. Ooh, Lieutenant Taylor sliding into position. There we go, those spots on the radar are somewhere in that group is going to be our target warehouse. Let's bring the range into 10 nautical miles. And we can see Nam Dinh down over below us here. We're 10 miles away from target, so I'm going to turn right and put it 45 degrees off my nose. And we can try to spot it down through this cloud cover. Try to get a visual contact with it before we roll in so I know what I'm looking at. That it? We have a circle of buildings. No, the target's actually beyond that. Looks like it's kind of close to, I think that's a power station there. Well, we're 6 miles out. Let's get a little bit closer and see if it pops into view, because it seems to be too far away. There we go. Looks like it's these three little dots right in front of us. We're 3 miles away. I'm going to go ahead and tell Lieutenant Taylor to attack my target. So he's diving down. Now I'm going to select my bombs. Okay, now I'm going to nose over, select my snake eyes. My precision bombing pipper, the CCIP, pops up. Oh, man. Alright, there's our compound. I think we're pointed either straight down, or we have gone... Yeah, we've gone a little bit inverted. Shit. Okay, bombs away. Oh, and I seem to have mostly missed the compound. Son of a bitch. I'm gonna blame my bombardier on that. I waited too long to nose over, and then we went past the target. Alright, so it's up to Cowboy 2 here to get what we need to get. Yeah, that primary target warehouse, it's still there. Oh, I guess it looks like I hit something. I did some damage, but mostly they all missed. Landed outside the compound. There's that power plant. Oh yeah, look, I got black smoke coming up from the center of the warehouses. Thick black smoke, something oil or petroleum based must be burning. Luckily, I didn't release the bombs and have them fly back into the wings, since I was entirely way too vertical. Look at that. Well done, Jack. All right, buddy, reform and let's get out of here and go back out to sea. So far, very little anti-air activity over Nam Dinh here. It's a pretty big city, but no SAMs, no FLAC, no AA, and it sounds like all the fighters are elsewhere, maybe up near Hanoi. Yeah, we'll climb back up to 20,000. I decided I didn't feel like doing the low altitude that they ordered me to do, so I chose 20,000 instead. And that's it, we're basically out over the ocean again. Nice and fast that time. It's nice hitting targets or cities that are near the coastline, because then you're not deep inside of Vietnam in case something happens. You know, if you get hit and you gotta punch out, which we've had to do a couple of times, it's much better to be right near the ocean where you can coast out if necessary. Also, it means you don't have to fly over and through a bunch of flak and SAMs and stuff. So, super derpy bombing run on my part. I apologize for that. But it worked out, because we still blew up a bunch of stuff, and then Taylor came in and finished off the primary target, so we're good to go now. And we can see Red Crown, the Red Crown picket ships on our radar there, as we're coming in 2 miles away from our waypoint. There's Nam Dinh, back there over our wing. We're flying away from it. Lots of air combat somewhere, but thankfully not near us. Now, after the other mission where I was bumbling around at 20,000 feet and forgot to do my descent, We're going to pay a little more attention to that, and I will start dropping altitude much, much sooner so that we can get down to our initial point altitude at the right time. I love how today looks. I love the layer of fluffy clouds here at around 18,000 feet, and then those really high altitude wispy clouds out in the distance, the two layers. I like how that looks. I'm going to turn towards waypoint 8, and then when we hit 40 miles, I'm going to begin my descent, which will give us plenty of time to get down in time to reach that initial point. On board the Enterprise, the crew had two options when it came to cleaning our clothing. One could make use of the ship's laundry, or one could sign up for a washing machine in the self-serve laundry. Both had pros and cons. Using ship's laundry meant putting all of your clothing in a knit bag with your name and division on it, clipping it closed with an oversized safety pin, and leaving it in the bin in the berthing. The bags would be picked up and then washed, along with everything still inside the bag, then returned to the berthing to be delivered back. Upsides was that it was hands-off, you didn't have to spend any extra time on it, and for the most part, it got done on a predictable schedule. Downsides were that the whites came back gray, and sometimes your bag just disappeared. Almost worse, one time my bag had opened up in the machines, and I got back an empty bag and a loose pile of my skivvies. On the other hand, upsides of the self-service laundromat was that no one else touched your stuff, there was no risk of losing things, things got cleaned more thoroughly, and you could wash your clothes at any time on your own schedule. Downsides were that you had to sign up on a waiting list that was usually hours long, and if you didn't come back at just the right time to hear your name get called, you were skipped over and placed at the bottom of the list, adding another 3 to 4 hours to your wait. If you were working on a schedule where you only had 6 hours between watches, this was a deal-breaker. For us machinist mates, though, there was a secret third option. We washed our clothes in the engine room. We had heard from the senior guys that this was a tradition that stretched back into the mists of time. When we finally got out of the shipyard and started going to sea for the first time for workups and carrier quals, a bunch of us junior guys pitched in and bought a bulk-sized powder detergent, which we stored in the plant. The best time to wash clothing was usually on the 2-7 watch, because there wasn't much to do and no one came around. There was no flight ops that late, so the plant was usually in a steady state. I would bring a bag down to the plant, not too obvious, but not too secret either. Opening a drain valve, I'd fill a metal bucket with condensate water and dump the clothes in, along with some detergent. I'd use a wrench or some other random chunk of metal to stir it like a witch's brew, and then I would hang it under a steam vent valve and blow steam into it to heat up the water. After repeating all these steps as necessary, the clothes were clean and could be hung up to dry. With an average engine room temperature of around 120 degrees, they would dry in the heat fairly quickly and could be repacked in the bag. However, as workup cruises ended and we prepared to leave for our 7-month deployment, the reactor officer and chief engineer sent word that they were cracking down hard on unauthorized chemicals in the plant. They couched it as improving our hazmat practices and insisted that any chemical found in the plant required a safety data sheet issued from the ship's hazmat control. It was leaked down the channels informally that this meant no more engine room laundry, and if unauthorized detergent was found, heads would roll. We immediately disregarded that order and found a nice, cozy, dry nook under the reduction gears to hide our giant box of detergent. I continued doing my laundry in engine room lower level for the rest of the cruise. However, I stopped being so brazen about it after an incident. Our watch supervisor one night, an electrician chief, came down to review and sign my logs. He came down the ladder into lower level, and when he reached the bottom, he stopped, staring in disbelief. Hanging from angle irons and valve hand wheels everywhere was a sea of white t-shirts and underwear, billowing like the sheets of some grand sailing ship. Usually the watch supes came by much later at night, and so I was not expecting him to come down at that time. I had washed and hung up every piece of clothing I had on board, including some uniforms. I stared at him, surprised, and he stared at me, surprised. Waving me over, he simply said, "I'll be back in 15 minutes, and all this shit better be gone when I get back." When he did return, I had hidden all the clothing, and it again looked like a fighting ship's proper engine room. He said, "Don't let me see that stuff again. You get me? I don't want to see it." So began the don't ask, don't tell era of my laundry. From that day forward, I only washed small batches and hung them on the rungs of the escape ladders so that they were well hidden from any passers-by, and in return, no questions were asked about the purpose of the large metal bucket that lived in the corner of engine room lower level. And there is waypoint 8. Lieutenant Taylor dumps all of his bomb racks as he turns away and gets set up to begin his initial launch for landing. I'm not going to jettison anything because they're just empty racks, and I hate the thought of wasting them. Even though this is a game and they're totally fake, and there's probably a million of them back on the ship, I just don't like to waste anything. So I'm keeping them on.
I'm Bingo.
Because of the perfect weather today, I'll be doing a Case 1 VFR recovery, which is our normal overhead 360 to land recovery. Here we go, we're at 1,000 feet. Hook is down and locked. There's the Enterprise there, sailing through the middle of the rest of the fleet. It's kind of a traffic jam out here.
Red Crown, Trout Fleet, Manson Waypoint 8. Trout 1, Red Crown, copy that.
Within a mile of the ship, 400 knots at 1,000 feet, coming over just over the starboard side of the ship. and I like to go out just short of a mile ahead of the ship to begin the break. There it is, 1 mile. Rolling out on downwind with gear and flaps out. Let's set full flaps now. We are abeam of the touchdown area. Still really high though. We're going to make our turn, and I'm going to dump a bunch of this altitude in the turn to final. Crossing over the wake, we're a couple hundred feet above where we should be. We should be around 450 feet right now, but like I said, last episode, if I stick to the realistic altitudes, I usually can't see the aircraft carrier around the cockpit, so this is a slightly modified Horner approach, so I don't crash into the back of the ship. Landing area is getting away from me just a little bit. Just easing the nose back to the right. Add a little power. We're at 140 knots over the fantail. Looks like we caught wire two. But it's a good capture. We come to a halt. And we'll fold up this plane, hook up, release the brakes, and then we'll taxi on out of this landing area. It would help if I actually release the brakes. Alright, great mission today. As we shut down the engines and head down to the debriefing room, we'll see you down there and we'll discuss the results of today's mission. Alright, let's see how we did today. The objective was to strike that warehouse in the Nam Dinh warehouse storage area. Flight time was 33 minutes, 13 seconds. Primary target was destroyed for a success of 445. Here in the stats. Here's 20 snake eyes. Despite our idiotic approach, we still got 8 kills for 20 hits. Lieutenant Taylor only fired 19 of his 20 for some reason and got 5 kills, but that included the primary target. Let's see, our derpy snake eyes, we destroyed a building, fuel tanks, oil drums, a barrack, a building, a water tower. And we hit the warehouse with the snake eyes, but apparently didn't destroy it. Lieutenant Taylor destroyed the warehouse, vehicle ports, and a warehouse. So 2 warehouses, 2 vehicle ports. And here he is, Jack Taylor, 13 out of ground. All right, another smooth one today. That's always a pleasant change from having people die on me. Thanks once again for joining me, and come see me again next time as we continue our Rolling Thunder campaign over Vietnam in the A6 Intruder here in Strike Fighters 2 Vietnam. All right, see you later.